Hello friends, good afternoon and welcome to EduSat Live Lectures. Dear friends, today in biotechnology we will be talking about proteins and its secondary structures. To discuss this topic, we have with us our subject expert, Dr. Unnati Gulati. Dr. Gulati is an academic coordinator at Consortium for Educational Communications, New Delhi. Without further ado, I would like to welcome ma'am to our studios and request her to start the lecture. Welcome ma'am.
Thank you, Amrit. Students, we have been talking about protein structure. We started off with the amino acids and we did their chemical properties and the resultant physical and chemical behavior of amino acids and how they had formed the polypeptide by joining by the condensation reaction giving rise to the peptide bond and giving us the polypeptide, which was continuous sequence of amino acids each joined by the peptide bond. So today we will go and discuss these following topics. We will talk about some unusual amino acids. What are some smallest of the amino acid sequence or smallest of the peptide that can be functional? We will talk about the secondary structure elements and we will see how amino acids, because of their chemical nature, because of the specific R group, will show you some bias for either of the secondary structures. Then we will talk about Ramachandran plot and then look at tertiary and quaternary structures, and also we will talk about briefly the forces that stabilize the protein. So first we will talk about are the uncommon amino acids. We are aware of only 20 amino acids which get included or which are inclusive of all proteins that are found. But that doesn't mean that there are no other amino acids which will be functional. We can say there are around 300 amino acid like molecules, but only 20 of them become part of the protein. So other than that, there are also derivatives or slightly chemically modified forms of amino acids which we encounter, and they may not be part of protein or they may be part of some proteins and have specialized function. As you will see, 4-hydroxyproline, which is a modified proline, it is found in collagen and in plant cell walls. 5-hydroxylysine, which is again a modified lysine with the hydroxy group, the fifth position, it is also found in collagen, and this is the critical amino acid for which synthesis we require vitamin C, and if we do not have vitamin C, it results in scurvy. GN-methyllysine is also another modified amino acid which is constituent of myosin. 1-carboxyglutamate, which is having 2 carboxyl groups. You know, glutamic acid is having 1 carboxyl group, but this is having 2 carboxyl groups, and this is found in prothrombin, which is very important for blood clotting as it will bind calcium. Others are desmosine, which is derivative of 4 lysines, and you will find it incorporated into the protein elastin. And selenocysteine is a selenium containing serine, which is also found in protein, but this is added post translationally, or it is added once the protein polypeptide chain has been formed after the translation mechanism. So these are unusual derivatives of protein which are incorporated into the derivatives of the amino acids which eventually get incorporated into the protein. Similarly, thyroxine is an iodinated derivative of tyrosine, and for this we require iodine. Then you have N-methyl arginine and N-acetyl lysine, and these are also found in those proteins which have DNA binding, such as the histones. Proteins can have amino acids which can get chemically modified by either addition of a phosphoryl, methyl, acetyl or adenyl or ribosyl group, and these are very important for enhancing the protein catalytic activity. Many a times we look at the signaling pathway, there you know that there is addition of a phosphate group, so you could have a phosphate added or a removed by these serine, threonine or tyrosine phosphatases or kinases. But now we look at a list of those amino acids which are not incorporated into the proteins. So they still have some important roles, and you will see most of them are very important in neurotransmission. One of them is important in urea cycle. So we have GABA, which is an inhibitory neurotransmitter. We have epinephrine, which is similar to your adrenaline, histamine, which is derived from histidine, and serotonin, which is derived from tryptophan, which is also a neurotransmitter. And this neurotransmitter, as we know, brings the feeling of calmness. It is associated with the GI tract. And we have ornithine, which is again a modified amino acid, very important in the biosynthesis of arginine, and it occurs in the urea cycle. So these are some of the amino acids which are modified amino acids, not found in the protein, but they do have very relevant metabolic and biochemical functions. So what is the smallest? We were looking at the examples of how big and how large protein can function. So what is the smallest unit that can be functional? We will see that even three peptides long polypeptide is functional. So some examples are here. We have a hormone oxytocin, which is having only 9 amino acids. You can see the amino acid sequence here. It's a very crucial hormone which is secreted by the hypothalamus posterior pituitary, and it is the hormone which stimulates bonding among people. It causes uterine contraction and milk letdown. Then you have thyrotropin releasing factor, which is having only 3 amino acids, and it stimulates the release of another hormone, which is thyrotropin, from the anterior pituitary. Also, you have certain antibiotics and certain poisons, which are just very small peptides. So there are the example of antibiotics. These are indolecithin and magnanin, which are found in amphibians. There is a long list of peptide antibiotics that can be obtained from sealant rates and obtained from amphibians. Another small 3 peptide structure, which is very important, and it is important for its detoxifying and anti-aging properties, because it regulates the redox and the free radical movement in the cell. This will occur in all the cells, which is glutathione. It is constituted of glutamic acid, and it will have cysteine and glycine. So you can look at the structure here, which is showing the glutamic acid unit, the cysteine unit with the SH, and the glycine end. So in the glutamic acid, the COO is again the part of the backbone, and this takes care of all the oxidative stress because of the SH group, which can undergo oxidative reductive reactions. There are key hormones such as glutathione reductase and glutathione peroxidase, which is able to convert the glutathione, which is the reduced form, to a oxidized form, and hence it takes up the oxygen and free radicals. So we can see that not just you don't need a basic, there is no limit to what is the basic functional protein is, but you will also encounter very large assemblies, such as very frequently known molecule of known protein, which is hemoglobin, which is having 4 subunits. So there is a diversity in number of amino acids which are functional to the size which is functional. So you will have multi subunit proteins, you will have peptides, you will have oligomers, which are protomers, you will have hemoglobin like molecules which have subunits, and you will have insulin like protein molecules which have chains which are bound covalently through disulfide linkages. So also with the proteins, we will encounter what is polymorphic protein. Is the amino acid sequence very crucial all the time? I mean, if you are changing even 1 or 2 amino acids, will that change be patiently tolerated and the function of the protein will not be disrupted? So what are the crucial amino acids which are going to be affected? If you replace them, can the function still be restored? So these are the issues we talk about when we talk about polymorphic proteins. And you are also must be aware about polymorphic genes, where you have an allele which is present in the population So you have even 1% of an allele existing in the population, it will result in a protein, or it will result in an expression of a protein which is slightly different from the other. So there are around 20 to 30 known polymorphic proteins, and they will have a different amino acid sequence, but they may be having the same function. So many of these variations could not always be mutative, but can be polymorphic. There is a slight difference between what is polymorphic and what is a mutation. So we will also talk here about silent mutations. The mutations which occur, which do not lead to large disparity in the change of the amino acid present at a location, and if you replace an amino acid with an amino acid from the similar group, with the similar R group, you might have a silent mutation where the function of the protein may not be entirely disrupted. So another thing we can study here is, we are looking at the relation between the size of the protein and number of amino acids. So can we derive a formula in which we can calculate the molecular weight of a protein by just knowing the number of amino acids that are present in the protein? Or we can do the vice versa, we can derive the number of amino acids present in a protein if we know the entire molecular weight of the protein. So we have a very simple calculation done here. If we list down all the amino acids and we take an average molecular weight, we will find it is roughly around 138 Daltons. But to simplify these things, not all amino acids are incorporated at the same frequency. By frequency, I mean to say that some of the amino acids occur more frequently, you will encounter them more often in the protein, and some will be occurring very rarely, such as your aromatic amino acids may not be occurring very frequently in most of the proteins. So we will take the weight of those amino acids which occur more frequently, and that comes out to be around 128. So this 128 is a weight of one amino acid. And once you undertake this amino acid and undergo the peptide bond formation, there is going to be emission of one water molecule, which is 18 molecular weight. And this, when deducted, you get approximately 110 molecular weight. So that eases for us. If we have a 60 kilo Dalton protein, we simply divide the 60 kilo Dalton with this molecular weight of an average frequently found amino acid, and we can predict that these are going to be roughly the number of amino acids that are present in this protein. This is very helpful when we are doing electrophoresis and we want to determine is a protein present as a dimer, or is it having subunits or chains, or if we want to find out what is the molecular weight of the protein of interest. So this can give you a very rough and quick calculation, and it is suitable over a wide range of proteins also. We were talking about the peptide bond, and we were talking about how condensation reaction is occurring with the carbonyl group of the carboxyl group of the first amino acid with the amide group of the second amino acid, and this directionality will be maintained as we go from the free N terminal as seen here, the purple N with the hydrogens. So this free N terminal and this free carboxyl terminal. So this directionality will be maintained, and once you omit one water molecule, we get this peptide bond. Although shown here as a single bond, we see only a single line here, otherwise you see double bonds are written very clearly as double bonds. So what is the nature of peptide bond? The peptide bond, because of the charge distribution, we have carbonyl carbon and we have amide nitrogen. Nitrogen is having two lone pairs of electrons, and carbonyl carbon is also having two lone pair of electron, but the electronegativity of the oxygen will pull all the electrons towards it, creating a partially negative charge around this oxygen and the partial positive charge around this nitrogen. But this oxygen and nitrogen will have a sharing of this of the electrons, of the lone pair of electrons, and it will result in a resonance kind of a structure. So the electrons are not residing all the time with either of oxygen or of with nitrogen, and it is somewhere in between. This results in a partial double bond like character, or you can say results in a not in a bond which is not like a single bond. And what are the properties that this very small observation leads to, we will see now. So when we look at the peptide bond, we will see that this C and this is the C alpha, the primary carbon to which all the R groups are attached. Then this is the C prime, which is the carbonyl carbon, which is going to form the peptide bond. Peptide bonds will not have the same bond length as either your single bond or your double bond. It is very easily the average of the two, and the data will show you that. So here we are looking at what is the cis and trans conformation which you encounter in the peptide bond. Cis configuration is not very easily, energetically favorable, because you see these bulky two R groups are coming very close together. Hence it will cause steric hindrances and it will not be energetically stable. But you look at here, the R groups are present at opposite ends, and hence this trans kind of peptide bond is much suitable. So you will also see here that the gray area is showing the plane of the peptide bond. So in this plane you will not see any kind of torsion. Torsion means that there is going to be no rotation around the C and the carbonyl carbon and the amide nitrogen bond. This bond, what is, we are going to call it as the omega or the peptide bond, and this bond length is about 10% shorter than the usual single carbon and nitrogen bond. So that means it is going towards a entire double bond, but still it is not a double bond because of the resonance and because of the sharing of the lone pair of electrons. So we understood what is the configuration which we will encounter mostly. We will encounter most of a transpeptide, and also this cis and trans kind of configuration also has bearing on the secondary structure that we will eventually talk about. So we see here that the typical carbon nitrogen bond length, if it is 1.47 angstrom, then the double carbon and nitrogen bond length is around 1.27 angstrom. Then your carbon, then your carbonyl carbon and amide bond, which is the peptide bond, is around 1.33. So it's roughly the average, and somewhere in between. So again, we will see that this bond, which is omega, it's not going to bulge, it is not going to bend, or it will not show any flexing kind of movement. It will remain rigid, and along with it, it will also make this CN and C alpha in the same plane as C alpha and N. So we can safely say that omega is always going to have a bond angle of 180 degree, or you can say 0 degree. In the peptide bond, there are other groups that are going to be present, the C alpha group which is attached to the carbonyl carbon, and then you also have another C alpha group which is attached to the amide nitrogen. So there can be some flexibility, or I would not say flexibility, there can be some rotation kind of movements which we call as torsional. Torsional rotation will occur around the axis of the bond, and the NC and CC can show the torsion or the rotations. And any single bond, which if you have no other R group present, then all the single bonds are going to be free to rotate around the axis. But because of the R group being present, we will have restricted rotation around these torsional angles. What is a dihedral and what is a torsional rotation? So when we are talking about a dihedral,
Dihedral is an angle which is formed between two planes. If we have a plane, like you can see in this diagram, in one plane you are seeing the first amino acid with the carbonyl carbon. So, all of the atoms are lying in one plane, and in the second one, the blue one, you are also seeing the second which are lying in another plane. So, the angle that they form when they intersect with each other, and the angle at that intersection point is called the dihedral angle. Very simply, if you open your notes copy and the area where you find the spine, so that angle is called the dihedral angle. And torsional angle is that if you are going to attach two balls to the end of a pencil and try to rotate it, you will have the torsional angles. So, this is what we have here to explain you better what is the two torsional angles or the Ramachandran angles that we are going to talk about. The two angles are phi and psi, and you can see here anything which is in the plane, which is marked by this green box, is rigid because of the peptide bond, and it will not show any flexible or any torsional moment. But anything which is having a single bonded, so these edges of these planar structures will only show twisting or rotating kind of movements. So, we have the C carbonyl carbon to the C alpha, it is the psi, and the C alpha to the nitrogen, amide nitrogen, you will have the phi. So, here again you are able to see, you can see by these curly arrows how the single bond between N to C alpha is rotating, is free to rotate. Here how the C alpha to C bond is free to rotate, and here also you have C alpha to C bond which is free to rotate, and C alpha to N which is free to rotate. So, these are the two bonds we are going to see that are going to show torsion, and this will result, the torsional energy landscape when you talk about it will result in how your secondary structures will develop. So, people were looking about how do secondary structures develop and how can amino acids which have already formed polypeptides, can they give some sort of repeated understandable secondary structure. So, Pauling and Corey were working on models of myoglobin and keratin, and myoglobin was worked by Max Perutz, Pauling and Corey were working on keratin, and they encountered certain aspects when they were trying to fit the X-ray data to models. And they formulated certain rules or principles that could contribute to understanding how structures can be existing in the molecule if we are looking only at the X-ray diffraction diagram. So, they were looking at those contributions, how can you lower the energy of the molecule if you focus on how hydrogen bonding is occurring or how your peptide bond is present and how those angles, the psi and phi, are going to be behaving. So, they first set down few rules that all four atoms in the peptide bond are going to lie rigidly in the same plane. As we saw in the diagram, this one, all the four atoms C alpha, hydrogen, nitrogen, carbon and oxygen, all these four are going to lie in the same plane. No matter what happens to the psi or phi angle, these angles are not going to move much. But you can say this hydrogen is allowed a little bit movement. So, then we have you have the four atoms which are going to be always in the same plane, and this is because of the delocalization and the resonance as we had discussed. The N, H and O are in approximate straight line, and hydrogen is allowed some displacement of 30 degrees or so. All carbonyl and NH groups are going to be involved in hydrogen bonding, and if you apply these rules, they were able to justify the X-ray diffraction structure that they got, and they were able to say that yes, we could see helices and planar sheets when they did fibroin, which is having lot of beta sheet, and when they did alpha keratin. Alpha because it was the first molecule that they studied, and hence we come to know it as the alpha helix. Well, these studies were going on quite simultaneously when in India, Ramachandran, Sashi Sekharan were working on studying how small peptides, and they were conducting diffraction studies, and they were making computer generated models. We will discuss those aspects. What are the aspects we need to keep in mind when we are generating such plots? So, first of all, we have fixed that all these four molecules, four atoms are going to be in the same plane. We have drawn them as small balls, but we have not given them the actual van der Waals radius that is accountable for each of the atom. So, if you keep that in mind and we treat them as hard spheres, then you cannot have them overlapping beyond a certain point. Anywhere there is an overlap between the two orbitals, it is going to be unfavorable. So, keeping in mind these two observations, we will look at the principles which were codified by Ramachandran for the Ramachandran plot. And he said that the bond angles and the bond lengths should be similar to those found in individual amino acids and small peptides. The peptide bond should be planar, as we have discussed, it is a planar structure with the four atoms. There should be no overlaps, no closer than the sum of their covalent radii. So, there should be stabilization, that is, there should be possibility of forming hydrogen bonding. And they have the two bonds, which are the phi angle, which is rotation about NC alpha, and the psi angle, which is rotation about C alpha and C. But a linear amino acid polymer with some fold is better, but still not functional nor completely energetically favorable. So, even if we get the structure of a small peptide, we have to encounter for other such structures, which may be other than the sheets and the helices, which will encounter for the further packing, and other than the hydrogen bonding we have to encounter for packing. So, this is a quick diagram, and you can see that you have the phi and the psi present on the y axis and phi on the x axis, and you have negative as well as positive values. Understanding that we are talking about a spatial arrangement of atoms, we have rotation or circular rotation around an axis. So, we can have rotation both in the clockwise and in the anti-clockwise direction, and for that we are saying 0 to 180 degree, and then again if we go back we go to 0. So, we have accounted for the freedom of rotation in this case. So, the areas that are dark blue are fully allowed, then you have some areas which are medium light blue, and they are partially allowed if you are able to give some leeway into the size of the radii of the atoms, then you can have these medium permissible regions. Then you have light blue, which here you have possibly you can allow these regions, but if you allow some flexibility at the bond angles. So, blue are completely entirely possible, but if you allow or allow for some adjustments and some compromises with the size and with the angles, then these other regions can also be allowed. So, Ramachandran angles did describe the rotations of the polypeptide backbone around the bonds between the C alpha and C prime, and this is called the phi, and this phi angle controls the CC distance, and the second one is the psi, which is NC alpha CN, which controls the NN distance. And this was the paper that published the Ramachandran plot. And omega again is the planar peptide bond. So, the psi and the phi angles are going to be restricted by their side chain interferences. And as you had seen the case of cis and trans, how the two bulky R groups had come closer would become energetically unfavorable. And those R groups were here depicted only as, these R groups were only depicted as round balls, but we can have very long chain aliphatic, we can have hydrophobic groups present. So this is what is talking about in this. Then we saw that it had a positive and a negative on the axis minus 180 plus 180. What does that mean? The sign talks about that if it is positive and we are looking at the atom which is in front of us and we have to rotate clockwise to bring it to an eclipse position to the atom which is behind, then we take it as positive sign. And the three scientists, Sasi Shekharan, Ramachandran, plotted the sterically allowed regions in peptide conformations, and they made computer models of peptides and then systematically varied phi and psi angles, and atoms were treated as hard spheres and corresponding to their van der Waals radii. So we can see in this plot, you are looking at a example of a protein here, which is plastocyanin, which is all beta sheet. And in this first quadrant, you see the parallel beta sheets are present, antiparallel beta sheets are going to be present, right twisted sheets are going to be present. And in the second quadrant, you have the region which is showing left-handed alpha helix. Also, please try to see what is the psi and the phi when we are talking about this region. So look at the phi angle of 119 and 113, which is corresponding to the positive region in the beta helix, beta sheets that you will encounter. Here in the third quadrant, you will encounter the right-handed alpha helices, and you see the angles are going to somewhat negative at the psi and positive for the, and the negative for the psi's. But look at this quadrant, which is entirely disfavored due to lot of steric clashes. So we know that not all regions are going to be equally populated. So what are the things to be considered? The favorable regions will be those which will have the least amount of steric hindrances, which will promote lot of hydrogen bonding. The backbone will be having energetically stable, and we can talk about how glycine, which is not having a bulky R group, is present across all four quadrants, while proline, which is not having a flexible R group, is going to be present or localized only in the region of minus 85 to minus 60. So these are the relative propensities of amino acids. So as you see the extreme cases of glycine and proline, these amino acids will also have a tendency to either be in alpha helix or beta sheets. But then we do give considerations that there are going to be some compromises or flexibilities that will be allowed in the structure for maintaining the better stability and for having a catalytic activity. So how do we use this plot? We can use this plot in two ways. First, it can tell us that what are the angles of psi and phi that are probably allowed. If we are looking at a new protein and we are trying to do an X-ray diffraction study, we can again study that what will be the total sum of all the amino acids that are present in the protein, and what will be the regions that that protein is, the amino acids in that protein are lying in. So if we know it is lying in the first quadrant, it may be a beta sheet. If it is lying in the third quadrant, it may be a right-handed helix. So we can go either by looking at the data points of at the database, looking at various structures and compare where do these amino acids are more probable to lie. Secondly, where all places do the amino acids lie in a protein. So we talk more about Ramachandran plot in subsequent lectures, and we take a pause here. Thank you. We'll be right back. Welcome dear students, this is the lecture 4 and in this lecture we will be talking about what are the secondary structures, how folding occurs, what are the interactions and forces that are responsible for protein folding. So first thing in this most important concept that we should know about secondary structure is that secondary structure is entirely dependent on how hydrogen bonds are going to be formed. The most important thing in the primary structure was the formation of the peptide bond, which was the covalent bond. There I did not discuss the covalent nature of the disulfide bridges to be formed, which I will also discuss in this lecture. So the most important thing after the formation of the peptide bond, after the culmination of the disulfide bridges, is the secondary structure. And the secondary structure, the only bond that is formed, which is the hydrogen bond, and what all groups are going to be important for this, we will see that. So in this diagram, it is summarizing what is most important for us, that we have a carbonyl carbon which is having lone pair of electrons, and we have a nitrogen which is having a hydrogen with a positive partial positive charge, and we have this acid base kind of placement where you have sharing of electrons. So there is one electron donor and one electron acceptor, and hence there is formation of hydrogen bond. This is a hydrogen bond within the polypeptide chain. This hydrogen bond can also exist between two polypeptide chain of the two subunits, and of course we have intramolecular and intermolecular hydrogen bonding. Also hydrogen bonding you will encounter when it occurs with these same groups and water or solvent in which the protein is going to be present. So this is important for secondary structure, it is also important for tertiary structure and folding of the protein. So it is the simple hydrogen bond, but how this hydrogen bond gives stability and structure conformation to alpha helix and beta sheet, we will see in brief. So a hydrogen bond is going to occur between two electronegative atoms such as nitrogen and oxygen, and when there is some same hydrogen which is present in between them. And energetically it is around 2 to 20 kilojoules per mole of energy for making or breaking a hydrogen bond, which is a very large range of energies. And these hydrogen bond energies, because of the sheer number of hydrogen bonds formed, can contribute drastically to the stabilization of the secondary structure or tertiary structure. So we are first looking here that there is variety of secondary structure that is going to be formed. These are non-linear and three-dimensional in the space, and you will encounter these secondary structures in small portions of the polypeptide chain. Both of them are having the hydrogen bond, as you can see by these three triple lines here, and these hydrogen bonds will also be stabilized by further electrostatic and van der Waals interactions, because you cannot have overlaps, because steric hindrances will cause these destabilization. So excuse me. So you have here as the alpha helix, in which the polypeptide chain is almost going around the axis of the protein, and we are starting from the carboxy terminal and going towards the amino terminal. And you have the parallel and anti-parallel beta sheets. Look at the way in which the peptide backbone has undergone a zigzag fashion. In this, they are exposing their R groups above and below the pleats. So we will look at them in details. In our previous lectures, we were talking about how amino acids have a tendency or a preference for a certain kind of secondary structure, and the reasons for that we will also see here. the helices pack because of the hydrogen bonding and hydrophobic packing of the side chain. So, you see all these amino acids listed down here are very much hydrophobic, and they pack better in hydrophobic packing and are good for helices. But with long and large bulky side chains, you will not encounter in the alpha helices. Alanine and leucine are going to be predominantly present, while tyrosine and arginine, which is long chains, are going to be less common, but I will not say they are totally absent. So, prolines are going to be alpha helices breakers, and glycine R groups being very small will also be alpha helix breakers. So, these five you remember. So, here we look at what does the alpha helix look like. It is a ribbon, if you turn a ribbon or a telephone coil kind of a structure. So, here the backbone is very much compact, it is not extended. You will see an extended backbone when we do beta sheets. So, any L amino acids we encounter generally in the proteins most of the times as compared to D, and we have discussed that. So, L amino acids will tend to give you more predominantly right-handed helices. And the dihedral angles between the psi and the phi will be occurring around 0 to minus 70 degrees. So, you will see a small negative but small angles in the alpha helices. And the peptide bonds are aligned parallel to the helix axis. So, if I draw a line in between, so all the peptide bonds are parallel to that axis as viewed from here. These NC alpha, as you can see, are parallel. All the side chains, the R groups are going to be outside. Inside there is no R group, only the backbone is present. So, you can see from the top view, the diameter inside is very small, 4 to 5 angstrom, which will not accommodate any of the R groups, and outer diameter is around 12 angstroms. There is a certain directionality towards how these carbonyl and amide groups are present. Because they are present towards the outside and they have to undergo hydrogen bonding, they are present in a very they are present very appropriately. So, all NH groups are going to be pointed upwards and all CO groups will be pointed downwards, and they will undergo hydrogen bonding. So, all amides are, NH groups are upwards and carbonyl groups are downwards. Not just that, another consideration here is that if you had an even number of amino acids, like say 4 amino acids per turn, then you will have identical groups which will fall in the opposite one. So, the carbonyl will be faced by the carbonyl and that will not be able to form a hydrogen bonding. So, in that case, it is only 3 complete amino acid residues and the turn is offset by another half of an amino acid residues. So, what you have one directly above it will never be the same group, and this will allow that NH and CO groups are going to be always facing each other. And this is ideal for the hydrogen bond formation. If you are able to understand this, we can go ahead that R groups are facing outwards. Carbonyl, if this group was present at this position, then there was no way it was going to form a hydrogen bond. So, it has to be offsetted, and if it is offsetted, now the NH group is present in front of the carbonyl oxygen, and hence hydrogen bonding is possible. So, here this is what we see. This structure is going to repeat itself after every 5.4 angstrom, and this is what we call as the pitch of the helix, and it will have 3.6 amino acids, not 4, not 2, just so that there is an offset. And so, there are going to be 36 amino acids. If you have a 10 turns, we will have 36 amino acids, and there is a separation of residues along the axis is around 1.5 angstrom. So, one residue and the second residue, this rise is around 1.5 angstrom. So, every main chain carbonyl and amide group is hydrogen bonded to a peptide. So, the fourth residue is always bound. So, you have the oxygen at the first to the nitrogen at the plus fourth position. And peptide planes are going to be roughly parallel to the axis. So, these are some of the considerations for alpha helix, and the distance, the right handed version of the alpha helix side chains is much smaller NH, and it allows for a better compact molecule. And Linus Pauling was the first to predict the existence of alpha helix, and which was confirmed with the determination of the first X-ray structure that was solved by Max Perutz for myoglobin and John Kendrew. Not just you have one type of alpha helix, which is the alpha 3.613 helix that we were discussing. There are two, or there can be more types of alpha helix which occur at other person frequencies. So, 310 alpha helix is there, which is 10 to 15 of all helices in the protein secondary structure. And these are those alpha helices which will occur at the start or an end of a long alpha helix. So, they are pre to the alpha helix. There are transition to a alpha helix, and they are going to have a hydrogen bond between the first and the third residue, not first and the fourth as in the case of the 3.1613. And then you also have 5-18 alpha helix. So, these are some of the helix types that can be encountered. The second structure we have is the beta sheets, and these are, they also show a lot of packing, and the packing is better and more dense than in case of the alpha helix. The typical values of the phi and the chi angles are going to be around over 100, so 140 to 130 degrees, as they were present in the first quadrant, if you remember. So, in the beta sheets, you will encounter isoleucine, threonine, valine. So, they are tryptophan, phenylalanine. So, being hydrophobic and being very good for strand, you encounter them most often. So, the beta sheets, we will not just say sheets, they are also called beta pleated sheets. So, they have a Chinese fan like arrangement, and this is because that each of the peptide backbone will show up and down zigzag pattern, which the R group is going to be alternatively up and down. So, if you are looking at the plane of the fan, and so there will be one R group up and one R group down, and this will cause the pleated arrangement. Another component in the beta sheets is that you will have them as parallel or in antiparallel. So, in antiparallel, you have N and C terminal. If you look at the direction, the C terminal to N terminal are going to be oppositely placed. The C terminal will be facing the N terminal, and hence it is the antiparallel. The other one is the parallel, in which both the C terminals are going to face each other and N terminals are going to face each other. Critically look here at the state of hydrogen bonding. See here, in this case where you have antiparallel beta sheets, the carbonyl and the nitrogen are showing very straightforward hydrogen bonding. So, hydrogen bonds are occurring one after the other. So, the next group is forming the hydrogen bond and the next. But if you look at the parallel case, then you are looking, you cannot have this carbonyl having a hydrogen bond with this carbonyl. So, it will form a hydrogen bond with the next amino acid residue, amide hydrogen. So, there is a slight offset of how hydrogen bonding is going to occur. Another feature is, of this kind of bonding is that this brings the two chains close in close compaction. So, another thing we encounter is the turns. When we are transitioning between going from one parallel to an antiparallel structure, this polypeptide chain has to fold over itself so that it can come directly opposite it to the other part of the polypeptide, and hence only then can it form a hydrogen bonding. So, we need certain residues which are small enough or which will allow a hydrogen bonding to the backbone that can form sharp turns. So, glycine and proline are very good when we talk about such turns. If you can see here, we are seeing a cylinder like alpha helix and a small short peptide which is not having any specific secondary structure, but that it is connecting to secondary structures or to alpha helices. So, these some of proline and aspartate serine glycine which are going to be present in these turns because of their short side chains and also because they can form hydrogen bonds to compensate for the energy loss which will be spent when it is bending. And more easily you will find glycine and proline, and so hydrogen bonds and dipole forces are some of the forces that are going to attract water molecules and help solubilize the proteins. So, there are some important properties of proteins. By the time you have reached to the secondary structure state, by just the contribution of hydrogen bonding and maybe the steric properties of the amino acids, we will look into more properties that a polypeptide will have because of the virtue of its amino acids. And what are those? So, these properties are hydrophobicity, the size of the aliphatic groups, charge and secondary structure preference, aromaticity, bridge formings and rigidity of the proteins, and flexibility of the glycine. So, second thing we talk about is once we have gone and created in the structural hierarchy, we created the peptide bond and got the primary structure. With the primary structure, we had hydrogen bonding. We got two types of major structures, which were the alpha helices and beta sheets. Then these alpha and helices and beta sheets occur in the protein, and not all of the protein is going to be in those rigid two secondary structures. You will encounter some random loops, some turns, which are going to give composition or globular composition if there is to the protein molecule, and these eventually will result in a tertiary structure in the three-dimensional space. You will have all the atoms being placed, maintaining their primary structure, maintaining their secondary structure, eventually under the forces of their under the weak forces of hydrophobicity, electrostatics, you will have the tertiary structure. So, it is also a non-linear structure. It is having three-dimensional spatial arrangement, and it is formed and stabilized by the hydrogen bonds, covalent bonds, hydrophobic pattern, and tertiary structure can be broadly globular or fibrous. Fibrous as in collagen, keratin, fibroin, globular as in BSA, cytochrome. So, all of them we will encounter. Another important thing is, why do we have any kind of a structural hierarchy in proteins? What is the basic need? And even when we have had a tertiary structure, what is the need that the tertiary structure would go and form a quaternary structure? So, what are those questions? And you should also think about them. What are the questions that, is it energetically favorable, catalytically favorable for a tertiary structure to further form quaternary structure? Quaternary structure is another level of structural hierarchy, the fourth level, where tertiary structural components undergo weak forcing interaction, hydrogen bonding, and giving rise to multiple subunits giving rise to a large structure. So, what are the benefits? And we will see there are the same interactions that are involved in the tertiary which are going to be again involved in the quaternary structure. The free energy, the delta E, is going to decrease further by maintaining these quaternary structures. So, you have further dissolvation and reduction of the surface area. and these assemblies have lot of structural roles. So we will question these things as we discuss them further. So quaternary structure, you can see here, you have several subunits, alpha chain and beta chain, and they are having hydrogen bonding. So these are spontaneously forming from the tertiary structures. Another hierarchy which we will be discussing further will be what are the structural components of proteins, and there is a database in which all the proteins are going to be organized on the basis of type of secondary structure that they are having. So we will encounter some of these definitions which we will look at in detail. The definitions of what is a class, fold, superfamily, domain, species. And this is what a motif or a class is. It is a type of a super secondary structure. By super secondary, I mean that you will have the same beta alpha secondary structures, but they come as a certain assorted package. You will have repeated alpha helices or repeated beta sheets in a particular set of design, and you will encounter these motifs across various families of proteins. So we will see how not just secondary structure, but secondary structure itself can form certain sort of assemblies which we call as motifs, and how these motifs are going to fit into domains. And what are domains? So motifs are structural units which are repeated, and domains are certain functional units. So we will see how these structural units are going to fit into the domains, and we will discuss these definitions. And we will also look at the interaction, the forces that we were talking about. So these are the interactions that stabilize the protein, and we will talk in our coming lectures about energies and the interactions that stabilize the protein.
Thank you.
On that note, I would like to thank ma'am for this very enriching discussion, and I would like to thank you, dear friends, for watching our show. Stay tuned and keep watching. Thank you.